In case you feel, still remember me, yes, I take current affairs classes, right? I hope all of you are reading newspapers on a daily basis.
Yes.
Myth or a reality? That is a question. No?
Reality.
Let's hope so. Okay. Now, the first thing you need to ask you is, like, are you in continuation with the last 1 week's current affairs or not? That is more important, because if you suddenly come and start reading today's newspaper, you may or may not appreciate it again, right? So if you have read in the last 1 week or so without any break, you will appreciate it in a much better fashion, right? So coming to today's Hindu, so once upon a time we discussed that leaders or celebrities should promote the vaccine drive because there is some concept called as vaccine hesitancy. So in that sense, we can see that Prime Minister himself has went to AIIMS. And all the senior citizens are now more or less eligible for vaccination. They have to register themselves. So will this reduce vaccine hesitancy?
Yes.
Yes. So what is the use case scenario? Where will you use that article?
Leading by example,
leadership. Okay. Apart from that?
Promotion of indigenous products, because the vaccine he took was the indigenous vaccine over the better claimed ones.
Better claimed ones. Okay. Okay, fine. Anything else? Anywhere else? Confidence building measure or trust building in the society through leading by example again, right? So please remember, when you write answers, these are the examples that make a huge amount of difference. Yes. So you must have seen a Sacred Games meme, right? Sacred Games, there is a Sacred Games Netflix. Kabhi kabhi lagta apuni bhagwan hai, right? So by reading 6 months of newspaper, you come to know that I am God, I know everything. But trust me, when you sit and write the exams, answers, it's very hard to recollect 10 examples of anything. So 1 year down the line, maybe when you write GS paper 4 leadership, you might use this particular example. That is how you should incorporate layer by layer. Only then you will remember the examples. Always remember, whenever you feel like you understand everything, just remember that quote. Which one? Kabhi kabhi lagta hai? Apuni bhagwan hai. Okay, you are not. Okay, and you are not even the smartest guy or girl in the room, right? Because UPSC will always be a step ahead of us, right? Okay. Now, Chinese attackers, right? So now, what are the problems and advantages of this particular article? Chinese cyber attack foiled. The thing is, in cyber world, in cyber sovereignty, especially there is a term called as cyber sovereignty. So when someone violates your cyber sovereignty, right, it's very difficult to prove it is done by someone specifically. Everybody knows probably it is a state-sponsored cyber attack. But the thing is, it's very hard to prove. Even American companies or even Pentagon has been hacked recently. It was supported by Russian hackers. But America cannot directly say, you know, you are the ones who have done so. We can always put the blame, but we cannot prove it. That is the problem with cyber security threats. So always remember, when newspapers have the luxury, you may or may not have that luxury to write the same in the answers. It is allegedly or supposedly backed by China. If there is an explicit and clear statement by government of India or MEA itself, you can use the same language. Clear? Now, here one important term you have to remember is critical infrastructure. Critical infrastructure. So what are all the other critical infrastructures in India? Banks. Finance related, anything related to finance is critical infrastructure. Power. GST. GST network is totally run by online. Yes. Aadhaar. Telecom sectors. Power sectors. So nuclear reactors. Even army communication or internal security communication, right? So all these are critical infrastructure. If any of them cripple, economy will face huge losses. So if you see today's business section, there is an article which says NSE has crashed. It is a bug. What if some foreign nation created that, hypothetically speaking, right? What will happen? People will lose trust on the stock markets, right? So there will be a long-term ramifications. So critical infrastructures, when you make it online, it eases the life of the citizens, e-governance and all those things. But the problem is, you are always prone to cyber attacks as well. So the better easy understanding for you is Die Hard 4. There is a movie called as Die Hard 4. So if you watch it, you will understand how entire system will cripple if a hacker capable enough to cripple the system. So it's a cat and mouse game. You try to upgrade the securities, they will try to create better exploitations. Okay. And when it comes to nuclear reactors, recently we have seen there was an attack in India. Some malware or spyware was tried to be sent to a nuclear reactor. It is called as air gapping. Air gapping means this is core nuclear reactor. It is totally cut out from the internet access. In spite of that, hackers were able to access that. So the existing technologies may or may not be sufficient for critical infrastructures, right? Now, what will happen if on a one fine day when the entire country's grid is shut down? Because one nation, one grid. We have one nation, one grid. Economic activity will come to standstill. Hospitals. If you see Gorakhpur example, why did so many kids die in Gorakhpur? Lack of oxygen cylinders. Let's say you have oxygen connections through electric means or something, and all the system came to standstill. There is no backup generator or something. Then, yes, it will create a lot of problems. I hope you understand. Right. Now, what can we do to make it better? There is already enough infrastructure, but that infrastructure has to be upscaled and upgraded, especially in the light of Galwan Valley incident. And China is very capable of cyber exploitation. China, Russia, North Korea, all these countries have heavily invested in cyber attacks. Clear? Right. And G23, don't confuse it with G20 or some international organizations. Totally useless. We can skip it. Yes. Minor girl, that article we can use in Protection of Children Against Sexual Offenses Act. And if you see the last 1 week newspaper articles, these things have increased. So on an ethical perspective, you can always ask, did our morals as a society has come down? Right? Okay. Now, right. So whenever you need newspaper, I always used to tell one thing, apply filters, right? Apply filters. You need to have a discretion. So Hindu is trying to add some masala, or almost all medias are trying to add some masala. If there is no masala, nobody will read. Yes or no? So the context here is Supreme Court asked a man accused of raping a girl to marry. So what are the ramifications? Trivialization of the trauma of the victim. Okay. And it will set a very wrong precedent also. Yes.
Also gave a judgment.
Raki to your that particular molester, right? And one more thing you have to remember is recently NCRB data or Supreme Court data said, I think in Delhi, every 5 minutes there is a rape or some similar article. So in that particular article, the police officers say half of the cases are about live-in relationships. First you are in live-in relationship, then somehow it didn't work out. Now you are calling it as a rape. So rape cases have increased through that means also. So if such judgments, you know, Supreme Court has a whole different intention, but if this is a prima facie intention, what will happen? It will set a very, very wrong precedent in the society, and it will reinforce patriarchy. So it's a very, very bad example. Please remember that. Okay, again, as I told you, in how institutions reinforce patriarchy, this is one example. Yes, as the High Court asked, you know, go and tie Rocky to that particular person. That is also an example for institutions reinforcing patriarchy. You don't know that you are doing, but you are reinforcing patriarchy, right? This article is there in Hindu Hyderabad edition, IIT Delhi. Okay. So there is an art. It's not working. That particular app has an issue, I guess. Okay, I will share it anyhow, don't worry. This particular article says one thing, that someone in IIT Delhi has developed a mechanism to use e-waste. What will happen because of that? The advantages are oil spillage cleaning. So that e-waste which has been reused, that can be used to control oil spillage. So that is more useful for prelims rather than mains, right? I will share it. I thought it's in Hyderabad edition also. This article, compensation sought for wrongful confinement. Okay. So somebody from Uttar Pradesh was arrested 12 years ago. Okay, in a terror related case, and he was not charged and he was not found guilty for 12 years and he was languishing in the jail. Languishing is the exact term used by the judge himself, right? Why languish? Because you didn't do anything wrong and you are suffering in the jail. Either you have to be punished or you should be released, right? Guilty or not. But taking away someone's life for 12 years, the mental trauma he will go through and his family will go through. So here the human rights groups are asking for compensation, 1 crore rupees or something. You must see, this is a template which you can find in many states. Whenever there is a terror attack or something, people belonging to a particular religion are arrested by default, right? And sometimes they are proved guilty and sometimes they are not proved guilty. So he was suspected to be a member of that entire organization. Now, 2 lessons here. What if he is really smart, he made sure that there is no proof and he was proved as innocent? That is one dimension, right? Second is, a really innocent person has been arrested. So as a system, what is the lesson you have to learn? Anybody can be in his place. Anybody can be in his place. Tomorrow, anybody can be arrested and put him in his place. So criminal justice system reform should happen. That means police should have more capacity to prove if he is really guilty as guilty. That is the lesson we have to learn, right? Not worry about that particular person alone. We have to make the systems better, right? What if he is really guilty but he escaped, right? That is also a problem to the society. If he is innocent, that should also be proved through beyond doubt, right? So that is the right lesson to be taken. Are we clear? Because when you say X is a citizen of India, fundamental rights are to be valued. To protect that fundamental rights, we have to upgrade the systems, not take the shortcuts. I will beat him for 10 days, then on the 11th day, he will automatically say, yes or no? There is a joke, right? Some other time, yes, okay. The vital but delicate task of reviving Iran deal. PSIR students, you need to keep an extra eye on this particular article. But overall, it can be summarized. How can it be summarized?
Either US or Iran has to take the first step. If any one of them stop taking the first step, it will be
If any one of them do not take any initiative, it will be the end of GCP.
You should take a more proactive role, come forward and then bring both the parties on the discussion table and try to strike a deal.
Okay.
Since it's a political dilemma, even though Iran was following all the rules of JCPOA, Trump withdrew the pact and he imposed the sanctions. Now the only demand is to remove the sanctions. So, and they are ready to get back into the JCPOA. So it's the political dilemma for the Biden government to take this.
Okay, here, is it really that simple? Who are the stakeholders involved? Actually, we are seeing 3 major characters in this particular article. One is EU, Iran and USA. But is it actually the true picture? We all know Saudi Arabia, the skirmishes of the West Asia are totally involved. See, Saudi Arabia and Israel have lobbied Donald Trump. That is why he was able to successfully pull out of JCPOA, right? So that is the first thing we have to remember. And second thing, as he rightly points out, maximum pressure has been applied by USA. At the same time, retaliation has also been done by Iran. How do you wash out all that bad blood? Aramco has been attacked by Iran, right? Aramco, the Saudi oil company, has been attacked by Iran. So Saudis won't be happy with USA if USA allows Iran to join JCPOA. So many relations are interlinked here rather than the simplistic picture this particular article portrays. Second thing, who is the net security provider? USA, right? Not EU. and EU did not say we will sponsor some money or we will take the burden, and they will never do that, right? So at the end of the day, the burden has to be lifted by US alone. So it's more of a discussion between Iran and USA, and how USA manages its friends, right? Because Iran per se doesn't have any lobbying pressure or lobbying force on USA, right? The only power that Iran or North Korea have is nuclear weapons. That is the only lobbying card they have. Whereas the friends of USA are having a direct access to USA, right? So the only way Iran can bring people to discussion table is by saying, I am going to enrich uranium. Come start discussing or I will enrich. So the more burden will be on US and US allies rather than on Iran per se. As all of you remember, China is also a silent actor. $400 billion deal has been made with Iran. So if Iran is moving towards China, automatically US should rethink its strategy. And again, it's nobody's case to argue that US is doing the right thing or the wrong thing, because the burden will be bear by USA at the end. Now, what is India's interest in this particular article? Energy security, that is the first term. Yes, if sanctions are removed on Iran, what will happen? We will have more access to oil, and probably we can use Iran friendship to access West Asia, yes, Afghanistan, even to control Pakistan, because encircling of Pakistan will happen if Iran is back under our friendship, not control. Okay. Yes.
Sir, as a nuclear nation, why only emphasis on Iran and even those nations like North Korea? Only because of its strategic position in West Asia?
North Korea is totally under the rule of thumb of China, right? So it's a very clear fact that North Korea cannot be removed from the thumb of China. There is no point in negotiating with North Korea, because 90% of trade or access to North Korea happens only through China. So North Korea is more like a proxy state of China. So if I start negotiating with North Korea, what is going to come out of it? Nothing, right? And second thing, North Korea doesn't have some kind of leverage. North Korea is not exporting anything, or it doesn't have any strategic location. But Iran has a very long strategic location. There is an article by Kenneth Arrow. If Iran goes nuclear, Saudi Arabia will also go nuclear, and some other countries will also go nuclear. A new arms race will start in the world. North Korea doesn't have that kind of threat, because there is already a military base in South Korea, which is American, right? So if anything happens to South Korea, immediate ramifications will be there. But that is not the case for Iran, right? Yes. Done? Any questions from that particular article? Yes, again, PSIR students, you should be able to cover it very easily. But always remember the stakeholders. Don't go for the simple versions. When you write answers, you have to bring in all the angles. Now, a loan waiver and a state fiscal capacity drought. Now, just think of the stakeholders and ramifications of whatever he is discussing in this particular article. Who are the stakeholders? What are the ramifications? Preferably in keywords.
Farmers. Mm-hmm. Farmers.
Do write down if possible. 1 or 2 minutes. It's a good article. Evergreen. Done. Haven't read? No. How many have you haven't read this article? Okay, good. Assumed it's about Tamil Nadu, we will not read. No? Okay. Yes, ramifications, who want to, okay, stakeholders, we'll start with stakeholders. Sri Prada? Politicians, good. People of Tamil Nadu. That's it. Banks, very good, okay. We'll also throw in farmers. Okay, all the stakeholders, right? I mean, all the people who are getting the loan waiver benefits. Students, in case of scholarships. Right, public at large, tax people of Tamil Nadu, we the people of Tamil Nadu or India. Okay, and remember, this is not the case only within Tamil Nadu, you can literally see it in almost all the states. So the keywords that you are supposed to remember for this particular article is fiscal federalism, right? Fiscal federalism. Next is asymmetrical federalism, right? Why asymmetrical federalism? I will tell you. Coming back to fiscal federalism and GST also, right? Then you need to know the taxes that states have for income sources. So after GST's introduction, the old dynamics have changed. The old dynamics or old habits have changed, and reality has to kick in. Once upon a time, if I'm a chief minister of a state, I announced subsidies or soaps. Okay, I have some alternative resources and I can take that particular money and use it for welfare activities. Welfare activities are very important. But at the same time, state's financial health is also equally important. If you see cooperative federalism indexes like ease of doing business index, right? All this says you have to attract more investment. If you are not attracting, what will happen? Your state will stagnate. Your incomes have dried up. Think about it. Not only COVID, even before or after COVID also, your incomes have dried up. Only alcohol, petroleum, and some other products are under your control. Right? So you cannot go on with the old habits. That is point number one. Next is fiscal discipline. That is a severe victim is the entire scenario. What is fiscal discipline? A farmer or a student or a bank owner or a self-help group or any women's group, all these people are actually paying interest to the banks. Right? Now if you come and suddenly announce, if there is election, I will loan waiver. I will waiver your loans. Next time you will expect you take a loan and wait the politicians to announce waiver. This will indirectly increase NPS. Why indirectly? Directly only increases NPS, because states may or may not be in a position to repay the loans to the banks immediately. So NPS will increase, right? Now, what other ramifications are there? If everybody starts giving soaps or subsidies for everything, minimum wage will increase. Availability of labor will come down in the rural areas. That is also a severe impact. Now, long-term ramifications. What are long-term ramifications? Let's say, take hypothetically Andhra or Telangana. They have just enough money to pay money to the employees or salaries to the employees. And there are some states in India which are facing difficulties right now. They are unable to give PF immediately after retirement. After superannuation, you are supposed to get all the benefits immediately, but you are not getting. Why? States don't have enough money. When states don't have enough money, right, the morale of the administrations will come down. Yes or no? The morale of the officers will come down. Just imagine you are not getting salaries for 2 to 3 months. Will you be loyal to the organization? That will also probably kick in corruption or rent-seeking behaviors, right? And most importantly, we are not going to spend money on administrative efforts or long-term reforms. When you know you have limited money, you don't allow the criminal justice system to expand or hire new technicians. All of these things will suffer, whereas unnecessary expenditure is increasing, right? So loan waivers should not be seen only in NPA terms. It has wider administrative ramifications. And if a state like this goes on to say, I need bonds, right? I need bonds. I am selling bonds. Somebody please buy my bonds. Or Hyderabad city, let's say, has issued municipal bonds. Will anyone buy? No. Why? They know you are barely surviving. And the last line, as he mentions in the article, it beautifully summarizes, right? In the long run, we are all dead. 5 years I will be chief minister, right? Or 10 years I will be chief minister. I can do this rotation work, I will survive. In the 11th year, when some new chief minister comes, all the burden is his, not mine. When you tie his hands, will he be able to do any administrative work? No. Clear? This can also be linked to the morals, right? When you know that these things are happening, why are you still investing in loan waivers or populistic politics? That is where 15th Finance Commission should come into the picture, right? And there should be a dashboard mechanisms, and states should be severely punished for having high revenue deficits. Not punished in the direct sense, but through moral sense or persuasions. Okay, because only when states grow, the nation will grow. If every state is in debt, India's overall debt will also increase. That is not a good scenario.
So can we see this in an ethical perspective?
Ethical perspective, again, that the last line summarizes, right? For 10 years, I will be CM. As long as I keep giving money to the people, I will be CM. Yes. You take any state, every state is becoming populist nowadays. Earlier they used to promise roads, electricity, power. Right now they are saying, if I come into power, I will give you 15,000 rupees per month, I will give you house. Yes? Yes. Yes. And people are getting free lunches. There are no such thing as free lunches. Why? After 11th year, the same CM won't be there. You'll have to find a new income source.
Is anything RBI can do to regulate, like most of them, what they have promised common priority sector
regulation? Mm-hmm. No, it is not priority sector. It is more towards, you know, let's take Andhra Pradesh as an example. Where do lawyers and auto drivers come under priority sector lending rates? Right? So, and more or less, RBI is an executive. It cannot tell state governments what its policy should or should not be. Probably FRBM Act can be managed, right, with a upper cap. You should not have revenue deficit beyond this particular point.
So the beneficiary is such that you can't even tell anything. It's always the farmer. So if you go against them, then there's a repercussion or backlash. So
see, again, subsidies are of different kinds, right? I'm giving you PM Kisan. Telangana have Raitu Bandhu. Apart from that, why do I have to announce loan waiver? That can be managed, probably persuaded, right? Again, I'm not saying you cannot do this. You can do this for next 20 years and still survive in India, but long-term ramifications will be the state's trust. Yes? Yes. Any other questions?
Sir, higher revenue deficit affects granting aid, right?
Mm-hmm. That is what 15th Finance Commission says. I mean, it's linkage. For example, if you are performing in this bandwidth, you will get more funds. You will be more respected. Your ease of doing business index will be better, or you will receive more funds from the central government. Above all, you will get loans cheaply, right? If let's say tomorrow some rating agency came and labeled Andhra Pradesh government finance as a C, right? Nobody will be willing to buy Andhra Pradesh government bonds, and that will have a lot of issues. You won't even attract investors. Yes or no? Right. So all these problems will come into the picture when your revenues dry up. Always remember, if India becomes $5 trillion economy, nobody will be discussing about these things. I'm a $5 trillion economy. I'm making so much money through taxes that I can do all these things and still maintain a healthy balance sheet. That is one way to look at the things. But things have changed after GST. You don't have that luxury. Even if your states are doing well, you may or may not receive the same benefits. So fiscal federalism has changed in India forever, and it is high time that state politicians understand that and rectify these kind of populistic behaviors. So the change should come from the people. Give it up campaigns. Yes or no? Will you give up 15,000 rupees subsidy per month? Yes? Don't raise your hand. Yes. You can always have my account number as well. Right. Yes. Clear? Okay. So administrative wise, banks wise, or long term problems by this article is more important. And always remember, it's not only about Telangana. Every state in India will do this sooner than later. And you also have to remember, Tamil Nadu is one state which is performing very well in human development indexes. It has one of the lowest IMR and MMR. You cannot say, you know, you are ignoring social welfare. So they are actually proving through empirical data also. So people have moved on from basics to something else. So that is why you have to depend on all these things. Clear? Right. Next. Cold comfort. Okay. So this article can be better appreciated if you also know that recently dialogue between Pakistan and India have opened up. Dialogue between India and Pakistan have opened up through LOC or LAC? LOC. Okay. Right. In line of control, we are having some kind of peace truce and negotiations between India and Pakistan may or may not take place. And whenever Pakistan says peace, always remember it will be followed by a terror attack in India. So security forces will be on extra alert. Whenever Pakistan or India offered a friendly hand to someone, it is always followed by some kind of terror attack or disruptive tactic by deep state actors. So remember, Pakistan is not only Islamabad, Rawalpindi, but also deep state actors. There is a third party, okay, which does not want peace between India and Pakistan. So it doesn't matter who started the peace first, India or Pakistan. It will always be followed by some kind of ramifications, and how creatively you will manage that is more important. Okay. Now, as the article is self-explanatory, Pakistan is still in the grey list. The good thing is they did not put it in the black list. Good thing is it did not put them in the black list. Pakistan is still in the grey list. It is because it is doing a lot of things that the FATF has asked it to do. But it's for show. Everybody knows Pakistan is not innocent. Pakistan did not actually arrest them. It is just showcasing they have been arrested or restricted. They will have full freedoms, luxury treatment, everything. Right? Now, what does this do for India? India is happy that Pakistan is still in the grey list. And it also shows India's soft power or diplomatic abilities to persuade international community to believe that Pakistan is actually a terror sponsor. FATF is applied only when money laundering or terror financing are there. So India successfully persuaded countries. If you take a decade ago, India was not able to convince many capitals in the world that Pakistan is actually a terror sponsor. Contrary to that, now many countries actually believe that. So it's a victory for India diplomatically. This on one side and the peace talks on one side. So you can say the peace talks are also an outcome of the continuous persuasion of India's efforts, right? You also have to understand that. Clear? Morally, Pakistan could not raise the Kashmir issue, and nobody is believing that Kashmir issue should be internationalized. That is also a diplomatic victory for India. FATF grey list shows Pakistan is persuaded. And third most important thing, China could not do anything. Right? China protected Masood Azhar for a lot of time, even resolution, but China yielded. So the Bonhomme or all weather friendship between China and Pakistan is also managed by India. So all these are diplomatic victories for India. So when you write an answer, it's like a 360 degree view. This is not just an outcome we achieved yesterday. It was a continuous persuasion from India for a lot of time. Are we clear? Yes? Any questions? We will write US. You will write 10 marker, you will get 7 marks, right? We will leave it at that. Yes. And Pakistan lost a good revenue source from USA. So that is why Pakistan is probably feeling the pressure. Just think about it. $38 billion are lost to Pakistan because of the grey list. Earlier, what used to happen? America used to give $30 billion or $40 billion to Pakistan for weapon upgradation or social activities or whatever. So I lost $30 billion, I gained $30 billion. Will my behavior actually change? No. Now I have two friends. One is Pakistan, the other is, sorry, one is China and the other is USA. Both are giving me money. Will I change? No, right? I'm Pakistan. If I'm getting money both from USA and China, then I definitely will not change my behavior. And China is, unlike America, very clear that Pakistan is what Pakistan. Right? Chinese are not that innocent to believe that, you know, if I give $40 billion to Pakistanis, everything will be fine. Chinese know how to use Pakistan's geography for infrastructural advantage. That is all there is. Are we clear? So probably that is also making some kind of impact. Yes. The rush to appropriate icons. No, don't read it also. Yes. One thing you have to remember is Rabindranath Tagore wrote which book, or what is Gitanjali? What does it say? We can stop it at there. Modern Indian history wise, who is Rabindranath Tagore? Did he participate in Satya Shodha Samaj or something like that? No? Arya Samaj. That's all. All Tagore brothers are important for prelims. Okay. And worst case scenario, you will use him in essay. The first Nobel laureate from Asia in literature. And his concept of, what is that? School. Shantiniketan. So Shantiniketan, the Guru Shishya Parampara can be used. When it comes to Swami Vivekananda, global icon, leader of, the maker of modern India, one of the key makers of modern India, and he bases his ideology on practical Vedanta. So those are the only keywords that you have to pick up from this particular article. Don't read anything else. We have nothing to do with Mamata Banerjee or BJP. Yes. Are we clear? Yes. And you can also remember V.D. Savarkar and Mr. Govalkar, both of them are also in a way makers of modern India, because all the ideology that you see of the right wingers right now originates from this particular person, Mr. M.S. Govalkar. If you read his writings, you will see more or less whatever we hear right now in modern India is directly coming from that particular source. So RSS, though, is an NGO, it has a lot of impact on political culture on India. Okay. Now, an unusual new media code. Yes. How many of you are following the Facebook Australia issue? Yes. So does this article make sense? How many of you have read this article? Okay, good, decent number. Traditional media versus online media, that is one way to look at this. Traditional medias are losing revenues, right? Normal paper. If you are not a UPSC aspirant, I'm sure you won't look or turn towards The Hindu. Yes or no? Probably only when the samosa guy gives you The Hindu, which something is there. That is how you will see. Yes? Yes or no? Or else you will see that 2 minutes slip that comes in the Google, right? Yes or no? That is what most of you will do. Only because of UPSC, you are focused to read The Hindu. So that is what most of the India will do. At least people who want to stay in touch with the news. Or else we have cat videos, dog videos on Facebook. We won't be bothered about news at all. And the most important source is WhatsApp. Yes or no? Yes sir. That is your primary source for news, right? At least WhatsApp is my primary source for news. No? Okay. Now, Rupert Murdoch, right? So he is a media baron, media mogul. He is the person who actually created this entire thing in an indirect way. So he persuaded Australian government to bring a bill to regulate the online regulators, online news media. Now, the simplest thing is when you scroll through your Google feed, okay, you will see a lot of media sources, Swarajya, right? NDTV, The Hindu, sometimes Indian Express, lot of media websites will be shown. You will read the snippet and probably move on. You may or may not open that particular article. Indirectly or directly, that is a source loss of revenue to the media houses. That is what this particular bill argues or believes in. Right. Now, what is the problem or what is the impact of this particular article? If you go to any media website right now, Hindu or Indian Express or even Live Mint, they have all gone for paywalls. Yes or no? Everybody is going for paywall. That means you pay certain amount of money to read this particular article, or else you are not going to get any money. And there is a very famous line by Times of India founder, Economic Times founder, I guess, some Jain. He said, I'm in a advertisement media, advertisement business with some news. Okay. And he openly says that I'm in a advertisement business with some news. Okay. Not the other way around. Okay. Even if you see the major newspapers right now, Saturday, I think there was a wonderful article which argues common man never subsidized or never gave money to the media. Hindu or Indian Express doesn't run because you are buying the newspaper. It is always gaining money because of the advertisements, the front page jacket ads, right? Or the classified newspapers. Even government is also one of the largest customer of newspapers. That means whenever there is Gandhi Jayanti, right? Or some national level event or the farmers bill event. So Prime Minister Modi came and gave some advertisements. Newspapers are not going to publish for free, right? Government has to pay certain amount of money. So there was a time where people believed if you are pro-government, you will gain more ads, right? If you open Times of India or Indian Express, you will find more government ads rather than in Hindu, right? Same day, just cross compare them, you will find always more government ads in Indian Express. So it's an indirect way to say, don't be critical of me, right? So if media houses are making money through advertisements and they are surviving because of advertisements, if I am sharing some revenue with them, okay, they may or may not be neutral. Yes or no? There are long run ramifications of whatever is happening right now. Yes? Amazon, Jeff Bezos, he directly purchased Washington Post. Okay, all problems solved. I have my own media house. Yes or no? Are we clear? So that is why nowadays, if you see independent websites, they are asking for revenue. If you open print or something, in the bottom you will find an article. News journalism is dying. Please donate. You will find in Wire. Even in Guardian website also, you will find for donations. So if people are directly subsidizing or funding the newspapers, things might change. Clear? Okay. Now, we need not go into the technical details of this particular article, but always remember, there are two media outlets. Let's say there is a young startup media outlet and there is a very big outlet. So if big outlets are making a deal with the companies, okay, small outlets may lose revenue. But again, internet has opened new doors. Even a small blog can have lot of revenue generation to sustain itself. Have you heard about Substack? Yes, you must have heard about Substack. Yes, in one way or the other. So what happens in Substack is, recently there is a $1 million company in Substack, $1 million newsletter. Just imagine, a newsletter is making $1 million per month, right? That is the power of internet. You can fight with the giants like New York Times or The Hindu also, if you have a good amount of loyal followers base. Things have changed, so things will change forever. And everybody is tailor suiting their own requirements. Let's say if I'm a leftist person, I will follow leftist blogs and I will pay for those kind of blogs. So echo bubbles can be created. Clear?
Yes.
Again, by the time you write mains, tons and tons of articles will come. Indian laws will be changed, so we can discuss them in detail. Master and the roaster. So prelims question, master of the roaster. Who is the master of the roaster?
CJI.
Chief Justice of India. Now, how many of you have read this article? Good. Yes. Any questions from this article? Application part. Where will you use this article?
Governance.
Polity. Okay. GS paper 2. Good.
Ethics.
Okay. Special in relation to that?
Morality.
Conflict of interest.
Moral values.
Moral values. Okay.
Judicial reforms.
What will you reform?
CJ power should be diversified. He should not be given that.
Have you ever seen a person voting himself out of the power? Ever? Except for the Bhutan king. Recently only the doctrine is finalized, right? See, in India, we are not following the judicial system that constitution envisaged. The constitutionalism has changed. If this is constitution, we are here. Okay, there is a huge gap between what constitution actually says, judiciary should be, what judiciary is today. There is a wide gap, and that wide gap is filled because of executive versus judiciary debate. Okay, thanks to Indira Gandhi, as I keep saying, democracy has been strengthened because of her actions, right? So there is a war between judiciary and executive. First judge's case, second judge's case, third judge's case, multiple other cases. So slowly they were fighting, like judiciary and executive were fighting. So one final day they came to a conclusion, okay, this is not going to work out. We will create something so complex that no mere mortal will understand it except ourselves, that is collegium. Okay, only collegium knows how it works, right? The top four senior chief judges of Supreme Court are collegium. Only those people will have understanding, and it's very easy when you don't have any rules. Yes or no? When four of you will meet together, we have to protect ourselves. What will you do? You create your own rule depending on the circumstances, right? So there is no rule, there is no law, or there is no article in constitution which says there is something called as collegium. Okay, and there is nowhere it says Chief Justice has the power to declare himself as the master of the roster. And one Chief Justice recently has declared himself as master of the roster. That's finalized. Are we clear? So remember what constitution says and what we are practicing are two different things, and there is no clear cut definition. But that is a forced compromise because of fight between executive and judiciary. Are we clear? Now, what this article says is, once I decide I am the master of the roster, that is finalized. Now, if the executive has to control, all you have to do is control the chain of the command. If you control the head of the organization, you automatically control the rest of the organization. Yes? So, now this article says, probably collegium should be the master of the roster. Yes or no? We feel good when we fall from frying pan to fire. Yes or no? That is one way to look at the things. The best thing for India to is have NJAC bill, National Judiciary Accountability Bill, to be passed and clear out the air of opaqueness in the judiciary. Only when the higher judiciary is transparent, the moral authority will increase. Let's imagine a very genuine Chief Justice of India has allocated a case to Hare Krishna. Okay, let's say he has done something, or he given a judgment in favor of the government, right? So still that can be doubted. Why did I allocate that particular case to Hare Krishna? Why not to someone else? Right? So if the Chief Justice or the entire collegium system is very transparent in whatever it does, and if there is a logic of every decision, nobody can blame or nobody can write such articles. So it's nobody's fault but judiciary's fault to bring itself in the bad light. So there is a high time that Indian judiciary goes back to the constitutional values. Clear? Yes.
We should create judicial ombudsman.
Again, the more we add layers, what will happen? more complex it will get. Right, and if you open Gautam Bhatia's article, the first line of the every article says this: justice is an indivisible concept, indivisible concept. Chief Justice cannot be a judge to his own cases. As long as Supreme Court does not resolve that sexual harassment issue of Mr. Gogoi or establish a mechanism which says even the Chief Justice of India is not above the law, only then there will be a trust in the judicial system. Yes or no? So that is a very important concept. Okay. Now, how do you create that? The problem is lot of political capital has to be spent. Government have to compromise a lot. At the same time, judiciary also has to be brought to the discussion table. If the top four chief justices of India are just judges of the Supreme Court and government can come together and solve this conundrum, that will be very good for the nation. Yes.
They coming together, isn't that a big problem? You don't want them to come together, right? That is what the constitution says, that you be separate and we will be separate. Bringing both of them
together. You bring, the solve here in the sense, you bring back the ideals back to the constitution. For example, there is no provision for collegium, or at least tell how collegium works. Have some act or some article in the constitution which says these are the powers of chief justices, are the four senior judges in the country who have the power to do this or do that. Only then things will work out. As long as there is opaqueness. See, even if you want to concretize collegium, bring an act. Yes?
There was an act, 99th Amendment
Act. NJ Act Bill, right? Yeah. So, which was struck down by Supreme Court itself. So, that is the problem.
I remember an old article, like how Supreme Court have evolved. From like taking the literal meaning of the constitution to the wisdom, faith and the belief of the people.
Exactly.
And again from the bigger benches to cutting down to the smaller benches of 2 or 3 inches.
See, there are enough constitutional amendment judgments which were passed by 1 or 2 judge benches, right? The term constitutional bench says what? At least 5 judges. There is huge vacancy. Yes. Okay. So, there is an article in Indian Express by C. Rajamohan, reading General Bajwa. So, this article also talks about India and Pakistan relationships. But for the simple understanding, I will tell you, always remember Islamabad in Pakistan is the legislative capital. That means Prime Minister stays there. Rawalpindi is military headquarters and there is deep state actors. So Rajamohan argues government has showed a lot of courage and Prime Minister Modi have a lot of political will and political capital also. Any decision taken by Prime Minister Modi more or less sails through in the country. So when he has such huge political capital, he can probably create some out of box solution for India and Pakistan. So when Pakistan general himself is extending the hand for peace, right, we should be creative enough to entertain that without trusting. I mean, trust in the sense, without blindly believing that they actually meant what they said. That is one thing. And we should be ready for some kind of disruption, a terror attack or something. Right. And the third one is, we have convinced a lot of world. Pakistan doesn't have many friends. Right. Pakistan doesn't have many friends in many capitals. Even India was in the invited for Gulf Cooperation Council, which Pakistan always tried to block. So all these things show that India's capital has increased internationally. Probably now vaccine Maitri and all these things, India's moral capital has increased even more. Okay. And the most major change is change the ground rules of Article 370. Yes or no? Article 370 has been totally changed in India's favor. Now Pakistan no longer can claim Kashmir in any sense, and internationalization of Kashmir did not work even during Article 370's dilution. So it will never work in the future, right? When 1 year we were able to put the Kashmiri people under lockdown, even then Pakistan could not cash it. Then now there is no way they can continue the same. And one more important thing is Imran Khan has said something. With Modi rewriting the India-Kashmir framework, Pakistan, Imran Khan is also saying we will finalize Gilgit-Baltistan. Let's say hypothetically that happened. Okay, which is actually India's territory. According to government of India's physical map, Gilgit-Baltistan are Indian territories. If Pakistan is trying to concretize them, the damage is more for Pakistan. Because till Gilgit-Baltistan you have claimed, let's say hypothetically that is your stance. From there onwards, every inch is Indian territory and it's finalized. Yes or no? So the damage will be more for Pakistan rather than for India. Are we clear? Yes. So do read this article. I'm sure it's very self-explanatory. So this is what Mr. Rajamohan summarizes. We don't know certainly whether it's tactical or strategic, right? Delhi will only find it by negotiating seriously. And as there is no opposition in the country and a lot of political will for the Prime Minister, even if he opens the doors with Pakistan, there won't be any backlash, right? And the rules of the game have changed. Pakistanis are, the deep state actors also very clearly know, if there is a terror attack, India will severely reply or retaliate, thanks to Balakot and other surgical strikes. Yes. Right. And there is one more article which will be useful for your essay. The right to repair. Where is it? So, European Union have decided to go for something called as right to repair. Electronic items should have spare parts available for the next 10 years. So now companies are creating products such that use and throw, right? And we don't prefer to go for repairs. Yes. So normally this increases the e-waste and normally materialistic concept. But European Union is saying develop the concept of right to repair, which says spare parts will be available. Yes. For 10 years in average, what will happen? People might start using the same products by repairing them. Yes. And the next future for mobile phones is also modular. Laptops or mobile phones will be modular. What is modular? Let's say I have purchased this iPad. This is a single piece of Apple. Yes. But modular means if I don't like the camera, I can remove just the camera and use Samsung camera. Right? Modular means it will give me the flexibility to use multiple company products in one thing. It's like assembled PCs in simple language. Yes or no? You either know Microsoft PC or Dell PC, right? But in Hyderabad, we go to CTC. Yes or no? We go to CTC and assemble multiple products. Now that facility is more or less not available for laptops. But in near future, modular laptops will come. I will assemble laptops. In the same way, I will also assemble mobile phones, Pixel camera, Apple processor, something like that. All these are still in developing phase, but it reduces a lot of wastage, right? So right to repair is also one out of box solution. In the same way, modular will also be one out of box solution. All of you just remember, modular is a upcoming concept. So the same thing will be coming for e-vehicles, right? Battery swap. What is the biggest hurdle of e-vehicles? I will charge, I will go to some place, there is no power, right? So people will be selling batteries, just like now they sell coconuts, right? On the side of the road. You can just give your old battery, take a new battery and move on. The companies will set up the shops themselves. Standardization. There is also an argument, right? Standardization of cell phone charges. Every cell phone should be USB-C. There used to be concept Nokia, the thick pin or small pin, yes, multiple types of cell phone chargers. But if you right now have one single charger universally, no problems, all problems are solved. So that is what Apple said to save environment, right? So see, all these things are done in the name of ecology and environment. Just imagine you writing them in introduction of essays. That will create a lot of positive impact, right? If you write the age-old example. Yes, plastic cover should be banned. Yes, it will be very outdated. Everybody knows plastic cover should be banned and it cannot be achieved. Yes, how will you get all the Swiggy parcels? Yes, bamboo straws. No? So it's a good example. See, this is all to save the planet Earth. So everything you do is for planet Earth, or to increase recycling. The four R's, right? Reduce, reuse, recycle and refuse. First of all, refuse. I already have a charger. I don't need a extra charger. I don't need that white headphones you give for formality. Keep them with yourself. Yes or no? All the 10,000 rupee phones will give you white headphones, right? Majority of us will never use that. Yes? Sometimes. Yes? Majority. Okay. Yes. Any other questions? You know, things change. We have to adapt. Earlier, there used to be a time when we see elders, we respect. Now we remove our headphones. Yes or no? Our culture has changed. Yes? So in the same way, when you write your answers, always use something unique. So that gives a lot of positive impact. If you still write plastic covers, it may or may not have the same impact. But if you write right to repair, even if they, just imagine if the examiner doesn't know and he finds out about it, how happy he will be. Like totally unique. Yes. So usage is more important. Also, there is an article about National Food Security Act in Indian Express. I have shared it. Just in case if you haven't read this article, very important for prelims perspective. For prelims, question will be like, what is the subsidy that is available for National Food Security Act? Percentage wise is more important. What percentage of Indian population is covered under National Food Security Act? So 75% of the urban and 50% of the rural. That is all written in the National Security Food Security Act. If you open Indian Economic Development, NCERT, food security, affordability, availability and accessibility. So the continuation of the same is National Food Security Act. This you can link to Food Corporation of India buffers. That is also happening, right? The MSP program, Food Corporation of India. Now, why this article is in the news? Because Niti Aayog is saying the percentage should be changed from 75-50 to 60-40. 60% of the rural population and 40% of the urban population should be beneficiaries of this particular scheme. So that will bring the number of percentage to 71 crores. So 71 crore population in India are assured food. They are covered under food security. Now, what is the problem if we continue on the same path with 75% and 50%? Niti Aayog says the population that will be covered will be 89 crores. Right now, 81 crores are covered. So it will go to 89 crores. 90 crore people will be under government's food security or subsidy receivers, beneficiaries. And it will cost government more money. Government is trying to save money everywhere possible, right? Why? There is always a criteria, right? Antyodaya homes will always be covered. Eligible households, priority households and Antyodaya Anna Yojana. So Antyodaya means poorest of the poor. They have a different kind of benefit and below poverty line families have different kind of benefit. So as she rightly pointed out, there are ramifications as well. 2011 census and 2021 census are totally different. Population has increased a lot, right? So more and more people will be deserving the benefits, and also it will have a lot of political ramifications. right? Especially when it comes to poor people, all you need is a statement. Government is reducing the subsidies and all the hell will break loose. Why? If you can attack one subsidy tomorrow, today, you'll attack other subsidies also. So don't let that Pandora's box open in the first place. Clear? So per prelims perspective, please read what is National Food Security Act, what are the provisions, the subsidy is 3 kg, 2 kg, you might find it very trivial, that, but these are the lines that you will see in the prelims hall, okay, and also the percentage of population.
Sir, how can we see this with relation to the three-farmers?
Bill, so by opening up of the markets, government can only procure what is required, because the Food Corporation of India subsidies will come down, right?
That will anyway result in this?
No, I don't think so, because on a normal level, government will always procure the required amounts, right? So it won't have any ramifications. And again, we are not going to touch that nor this in reality. Yes, any questions?
Work in these kind of subsidies?
I don't think so, because these are all not luxury subsidies, right? These are essential subsidies.
For the people who can afford?
Then automatical elimination will be there, right? I mean, you won't be a beneficiary if you have certain qualifications. So the government should have more stringent. High entry barriers, low exit barriers should always be the criteria. What is high entry barrier? That means if you have to receive Food Security Act, you should not have paid income tax, right? So remove all those people. So everyone who is doing something, they should not be eligible for the scheme in the first place. That means to enter the scheme, the barrier is very high and the exit barrier should be low. The moment you purchased a four wheeler, you are out of the scheme. Yes?
She was under BPL, then she was getting the subsidy. Someone, while they were transferring, they gave her a washing machine, and a fridge from two different. The next time they came, they revoked their BPL, even though she came, that okay, those were given to her and she had not bought those. So she needs the subsidy. So how can we say that? I mean, should she have refused such help from people, or should there be some additional criteria?
See, again, there are different identifications of poverty line. For example, if you see socioeconomic caste census, whatever you are saying actually applies under socioeconomic caste census. So if you are getting benefits because of socioeconomic caste census, it has this high entry barrier, low exit barrier criteria.
I mean, she had not bought those.
Second thing, you know, if you can afford a washing machine, let's say for you are having a home which has a tap connection and electricity, to run a washing machine. I do understand that you are not rich enough, but you have that kind of luxury, basic luxury, but many others don't even have them, right?
So she would not have bought an it.
I totally understand. Let's say I have purchased a car in EMI. I'm not purchasing it, and I am a cab driver. I am a car owner also. I should be removed. Right, the logic is still the same, but you are empowered in a different way. Yes, hypothetically speaking, if she is using all the washing machine for 1 hour or so, she is saving some time. Mm-hmm. She might invest the same time in house handicraft works, or probably she can generate income elsewhere. So that will be the government's thought process. I'm not saying it's valid, but government will think when she have washing machine, 2 hours are saved. She will use the 2 hours for handicrafts and she will save some money. Yes. So when you see the SECC criteria list, you will understand, even if you have a telephone connection, you are out. So what does telephone connection and poverty has to do? So telephone is a bare necessity right now. Everybody, even the poorest, I mean, what we call as BPL families also have cell phone connection. So on that criteria, we cannot remove all the 80 crore people, right? If you have a cell phone, you are not a beneficiary. So probably things have to be updated, policies have to be reworked upon. Yes. Yes. Any other questions? No? Okay then. We'll end the session here. We'll see you tomorrow again. Yes? Okay then. Thank you.